Here's a question. How many emails did you deal with today? 10, 20, maybe more? Now multiply your answer times every American who's online. It's estimated that people in this country send billions of emails each day. True, a lot of emails are junk, but others hold our innermost thoughts. They share intimacies, our complaints, or maybe our political opinions. And if you think your emails are private, prepare to watch and learn about a number of cases that each raise questions about how the government may be going through electronic mail. There is evidence the government has been intercepting most emails as part of its terrorist surveillance program. That program has been criticized as illegal because it's missing an important ingredient, search warrants.
Your emails and my emails and everybody else's emails were evidently going to a government room. The issue...
James Brosnahan is an attorney. He represents this man, Mark Klein. For 22 years, Klein worked as a technician for the largest telecommunications company in America, AT&T. Several years ago, Klein says he came to suspect that AT&T had installed secret computer gear designed to spy on internet traffic at the request of the National Security Agency, or NSA. AT&T handles tens of millions of emails a day, not just for its own subscribers, but for other internet companies too. Upset by what he saw, Klein decided to blow the whistle.
I've been struggling for some months now to bring it out into the light of day, and that's all really that I want to do, is bring it out there so that people can examine it and decide for themselves. And
this press conference took place last spring. Afterwards, Klein dropped out of sight, but not before he had taken an extraordinary step. A few months earlier, he showed up unannounced at the offices of the Electronic Frontier Foundation, located in San Francisco. The foundation fights to protect people's privacy. Kevin Bankston is one of their lawyers.
Based on Mr. Klein's statements, we have reason to believe that AT&T is assisting the NSA in collecting the communications and communications records of all or practically all of its customers.
Klein gave Bankston a treasure trove of documents to support that allegation. Bankston isn't allowed to talk about the documents in detail. The government has since had them sealed, but he says what is in there boggles the mind.
Would you describe what's going on at the AT&T facility as limited and focused or vast and broad?
We are talking about a substantial portion of all the communications traffic in the United States.
As a result, Bankston and his group are suing AT&T for violating the privacy laws which govern the big telecommunications companies. Now has obtained copies of what are believed to be Klein's documents. In them, Klein describes the construction of a room in the AT&T building in which he worked, located in downtown San Francisco. He even took a picture. According to Klein, only employees cleared by the National Security Agency were allowed to enter. Several work orders instruct employees to split AT&T's transmission lines and feed them into the secret room. One of them shows they were interested in a facility called May West. May West handles internet traffic for most of the west coast of the United States.
What we're talking about is the wholesale diversion of millions upon millions of communications from AT&T's backbone network.
Now, just so I'm clear, are we talking about eavesdropping on only electronic communication, email, and so forth, that's from the United States to a foreign country?
No, that infrastructure actually sweeps in an enormous amount of domestic communications as well. The same switches that carry our international traffic carry our domestic traffic. At first blush, that might seem a bit crazy. Who could ever manage to collect and perhaps even analyze that amount of data? But the fact is, that's exactly what the NSA has been doing for decades outside of the United States.
And now, Bankston says, inside the United States as well. According to Mark Klein, the secret room at AT&T contains gear which enables the government to look at every individual message on the internet and analyze exactly what people are doing. Here's another document. It mentions a company called Narus. Narus makes computer software that can swallow and analyze 10 gigabytes of information every second. That means it could go through all the information in all the books in the Library of Congress in a little over 15 minutes. The government has repeatedly denied that it's intercepting communications that are purely domestic. General Michael Hayden, the Director of Central Intelligence, has said, "This program isn't a drift net. This is focused." Kevin Bankston isn't buying it. But what exactly would the government be looking for? Bankston has a theory.
The NSA has developed automated computer systems that will scan those communications, whether voice or text, for key bits of intelligence, key names or words or phrases that are of interest to their analysts.
The government does not publicly discuss details of its terrorist surveillance program or what's going on at AT&T. So we contacted the company. They declined to be interviewed, saying only, "AT&T is fully committed to protecting our customers' privacy. We do not comment on matters of national security." Following 9/11, the government was criticized for failing to do enough to keep tabs on the terrorists. And after all, that is what we pay our spies to do. But what if that spying violates our constitutional protections? That's what Nancy Hollander fears.
I've personally never been afraid of my government until now. And now I feel personally afraid that I could be locked up tomorrow.
I've emailed him.
Hollander is a criminal defense attorney from Albuquerque, New Mexico. She represents several Muslim Americans, including a group called the Holy Land Foundation. You may remember that in 2004, the foundation made headlines when the government accused it of aiding the Palestinian group Hamas. To prepare her defense, Hollander spends a lot of time researching Hamas and in turn sharing that information with colleagues via email. In other words, Hollander is engaged in exactly the kind of activity that might draw the attention of government spies. In fact, her office sends hundreds of emails a day. Odds are some of them travel over the AT&T network.
I have every reason to believe the government has listened to my conversations, and I don't think it's just paranoia. I have every reason to believe that it's happening to me because of the clients I'm representing at this time.
Government lawyers had already told Hollander that her clients had been spied on, and she believes that even her confidential attorney-client communications were intercepted.
What did they say?
I don't believe they're trailing me all the time. I don't believe that anyone is listening to all my phone calls or all my emails. But I don't know which ones. And because we have these secret programs in this country now, we can't protect what we do as lawyers. And we can't guarantee our clients, our experts, our consultants that our conversations are privileged.
The Bush administration isn't especially concerned about this. In this letter to Congress, dated March 2006, it told members, although the terrorist surveillance program, quote, does not specifically target the communications of attorneys, calls involving such persons would not be categorically excluded from interception. It's important to note the Sixth Amendment to the Constitution guarantees defendants the right to an attorney, and federal law dictates that conversations between them be private. That confidential relationship is considered paramount to effective representation. For the better part of 20 years, the government has been ordering email companies to fork over to investigators copies of people's emails without getting search warrants. Officials justify their actions under a law written before most folks even had email. In court documents, the government has argued that federal law treats emails like a postcard. They say since the content of your email is visible to employees of your internet service provider, emails are, quote, not like a sealed letter. Attorney Weinberg calls that outrageous and unconstitutional.